Now that last video got truncated. I was recording the sound on the smartphone while I was capturing the computer screen, and the smartphone stopped recording after 30 minutes, so the last few minutes were lost of the sound. So I apologize for that. So what I'll do is go over that end again. Okay, so I just moved that video that I just made here. Now I'm going to open it up, and I'm recording what I'm seeing on this computer screen with my camera software, and the smartphone is recording my audio. Now, I should have used the Tascam DR40, which can store probably 50 hours of music on that
flash
drive.
Okay, now I'm going to show you some things on the computer.
So here's where
the it's much faster.
Where the audio got truncated.
It's not. Oh, I don't have
right
it
around 30 minutes. Okay, here we go. So 30. Okay, so here is where it stopped. So
I will. The Lexicon MX200 editor.
When it stops
like this,
playing back,
if you install it and click it,
I'll continue talking.
Open up.
From that point.
And it's not, oh, I don't have it connected. That's not, that won't work. Anyway, it lets you create your own sounds on a Lexicon and save them and restore them on a computer. You don't need it. But not.
Okay, so here is where it stopped. So the next thing is the Cakewalk by BandLab. That one is the software that I use for recording. And you can download that. Okay, so I don't remember what I was saying on the screen, but when I opened up the folder. Oh, that's an internet shortcut. Okay, you click on the shortcut, and you can download the software that I use to make DAWs. Now, sometimes software requires you to say, are you on a 32-bit or a 64-bit computer? And I showed how to, although that sticky text is on top of things. Anyway, this shows how to tell if you have a 64-bit OS. You can look at the settings or the control panel. And then back up the top, now we look at the samples folder. Yeah, the large samples library are tons and tons and tons of files that I have audio samples for that I've collected over the years. And I picked one at random. And I played it, and you can't hear it now, but anyway, it was a nice little sound somewhere. These are most of these are short little snippets, like the sounds that I've used to compose my stuff. And you can, they're free for public use, so you can, these are not, they're like attributable software. If you use them, you'd put the attribution in, like I use so-and-so software, and that's all you need to do to use them. So I left the original license information there for it. And let's see, what else did I cover? I think I talked about MIDI files next, yeah. In the MIDI files, there's a, MIDI files are playable on Windows just by clicking on them. And Windows will play the sound using its internal software synthesizer. And I showed the general MIDI test files here. There's 128 general MIDI instruments predefined. And I picked the recorder sound there. It's instrument number 75 on general MIDI is a recorder. And this test file is a simple little sample playing a MIDI note, some notes on the recorder sound. So those are useful, learning about general MIDI. What's next? Samples used to make The Only Way Out. The Only Way Out is that song I made for you with a sonar song. And those are the snippets of sound that I've made over the months to create that song. And then short samples I've made are sample files I've used the DR70 the recorder. I've made all those field recordings and samples with it. And then the only way out, this is the project folder. I'll be going into that in this video. And that's the other project folder for the other song I made for you, the White Christmas song and the Only Way Out sub-song. So now I'm going to be talking about Audacity in this video. So I think that's near the end. And I think so. Okay, so we'll stop. Yeah, that's the end of it. So let's stop that video playback and start the next thing. Okay. First of all, I do want to talk about Audacity, but I want to start with a little bit about recording in general. This is a link I made on my desktop. It goes to my electronic music site, which you probably know about. And I put the last two songs I made for you there. The Only Way Out and A Dark Christmas Dream. They're both here. I just added that last couple days. And on the very first one up here, it shows back in 1982, I made my first song on this synthesizer. Here it is. So this is in the year 1978. I spent a whole year clicking that image. Let's make it full screen. Okay, so here, full size. Okay, so here's me back in 1979 making this synthesizer. The synthesizer is very similar to yours, except I made it. It took me a year to build this thing. And then when I finished, that's what it looked like in the back. And I built all this stuff. I built that amplifier, the preamp, the synthesizer. Of course, I didn't build the speakers, but everything else. And through the years, my studio grew. And eventually, I got a hardware synthesizer called the Sonic VFX. And here I have an 8-track mixer, which is like yours, but a little bit bigger, a little more, quite a bit bigger. That's an Atari computer in my Stax earphones. And the rack that went with it. Okay, this is what a rack looks like. There's the mixer. This is the standard width for audio gear, and the Lexicon MX200 that you have can fit in one of these racks. You just screw them on the end and stack them up, and they're all designed to fit. So I had all kinds of rack gear back then. This right here is a Lexicon PCM70 from way back when. This is a Spectrum analyzer. This is an Oberheim synthesizer. This is an Ensoniq synthesizer. This is a patch-based switcher. These are a Nakamichi cassette tape deck, another Nakamichi cassette tape deck, and an 8-track mixer. So it's very, and then speakers up there, little tiny, tiny speakers up there. Okay, and then the mic boom over here. Then over the years, I've switched into software. So this time, I had an older system. I still have these speakers. I still have this keyboard. I don't have that keyboard anymore, and I don't use this computer anymore. But this is when I started going all digital, I simplified it. These MIDI keyboards only play notes. They don't have any sounds. All the sounds are now software generated. And then nowadays, I have my room looks like this. You've seen some of it already. And I have a subwoofer, two studio speakers, preamp. That's my computer. Same MIDI recorder, and then some software instruments here. But everything I do is in software now. I don't use any hardware except for the keyboard. And here's some more pictures of my studio. Let's see, this is the way back when. That was the Pia synth that I built, and that's its keyboard. There's a little electric piano. There's a 4-track Porta Studio. There's my patch bay for patch. Everything went to, of course I could patch up the sounds in the synthesizer, but behind it, all of the patches went to this panel here, and then I can patch them into the mixer. That's a picture. picture of my old studio, previous generation. Same picture, different angle, looking out my window. I moved this desk to the other wall later. That's not the same one. You've seen those. Okay, this is how I built stuff back then. All these things I've built. I built the oscilloscope, this test equipment, these power supplies. And there's lots and lots and lots of test gear and stuff that I had to build first. And then that's the way it looked. And then I upgraded a little bit, so now I have my first real hardware synthesizer. There's the ESQ-1, the Porta Studio mixer, Lexicon PCM-70, equalizers, sound spectrum analyzer, and my Stax earphones. I still have the Stax earphones. They're wonderful. That's the oldest picture I have of my electronic music studio, black and white. Gee, before color was invented. There's what the Porta Studio looked like. It's a four-channel mixer that records onto cassette. That's the Lexicon PCM-70. That's the real-time spectrum analyzer that I built. That's the Stax Lambda ear speakers. They're electrostatic ear speakers. Really, really, really fine. Fine, fine. That's a line voltage monitor I use to see if the power is good. I built that. Heath made kits. Most of these things are Heath kits. They're not in business anymore. But they sold kits to people to build. And I usually modified them. I built them and changed them. That's the ESQ-1, the synthesizer. My first real hardware synthesizer. The studio again. This is the Machina studio gear sort of thing. I was going to send this to you because I don't use it anymore, but it's a little too complicated for you right now, but maybe in a couple of years I'll send you this if I still have it. I don't use it anymore. It lets you trigger things on these pads, and it has a mixer built in and all kinds of special effects. It's kind of nice. It's a portable recording studio. That's the old studio. That was the stuff I bought to build my computer. These are examples of sonar projects, the biggest sonar project I ever did. That's the old one. Let's see. Really old picture. What is that? I don't even know what that computer was. That was still the Atari computer. I didn't even have a PC yet. Okay, that's studio, old studio. Oh, this is when I was building my new computer. That's the old computer, the old studio. And here I just built the new computer. And I'm transferring files across it. That took about a month to set up. That's what that new computer looks like. It's a real monster. It still is good. That was built in 2011, I think, or something like that. I've had it for 5 or 6 years now. That's somebody else's studio. I just like the picture. That's what it looked like. That's a side view. So that's what my room looks like now. Hasn't changed much. This picture's taken a few years ago. And that's from Forbidden Planet, the Krell Laboratory that I named my business after. All right. This is what? I think we just saw this. Yeah, okay. All right, now I want to talk about Audacity. And I'll start by opening the sonar project that I made, and it's on the flash drives under Audacity Project. And this will be an introduction to Audacity. What's nice about Audacity is that it runs on any computer. And I put it on a flash drive to make it portable. So when you plug in that Studio flash drive or the Patriot, they both have the same thing. They have a copy of Audacity on it. So there it is. Open it up. There's. I recommend using the Studio one because it's got, well, it's got 40 gigabytes free. The Patriot's got 70 gigabytes free. So you can record stuff on this flash drive using it. And it's faster. The Studio flash drive is very high speed. The Patriot's no slouch, but it's not as fast. So when you use the Audacity, there are two folders that are identical. This one has Audacity in it, and the next one is just a copy, identical copy, for backup purposes, in case something goes wrong when you plug it into somebody's computer, and you have a backup. So I wouldn't touch this one. And so if you go to the original Audacity and just plug this flash drive into somebody's PC, open that folder up and click Audacity, this is what you'll see. That'll come up. So I'm doing it now. This is the Studio flash drive, and here it says "Welcome to Audacity," and this is what it looks like. And it's a multi-track recording software that lets you record stuff, just like any kind of a mixer. And I made, if you say File Open. He's open. Why aren't you opening? What's up here? It's thinking. Here we go. Now, the reason why this is taking a long time is because I'm running a recording as I'm making this. This Camtasia recording in the background. So this is a little bit slow. So now, if I go to this is the Studio flash drive, and if I go to The Only Way Out, Audacity Project, and then click on that, Only Way Out AUP, that's an Audacity project file that I made, open it up, and it will load in tracks for Audacity that were used to make that song that I gave you. So these are all the tracks. Okay, it's a little bit sluggish until it gets everything loaded. It's a pretty big project. It's multi-gigabytes in size. So this could take a little while to load. But when it's finished loading, I'll talk a little bit about Audacity. Okay, they're still coming in. There should be 16 tracks. Okay, wait until the busy indicator stops. Okay, I think it's done now. Oopsie. There we go. Alright, so this is the project. Okay, it's very sluggish because of that recording going on in the background. Alright, so each of these tracks has an audio recording that I used to make that song. So if I go into it, I'll take a look at this particular track here. I'll click it and highlight that part. There's a small piece. And then I'll blow it up with the magnifying tool. Okay, so that's blown up a little bit. And you can't see very much here because it's such a small signal. So I'll zoom in on the size and let's see, blow that up. Okay, so there is the... Oopsie. Let's see. I don't use Audacity, so It's a little tricky for me to use it. Oh dear. There we go. All right. I want to zoom in on this sound right here. Click, click. Okay, there. And then if I play this, I hear the little pings. And if you press the shift key, then this turns into the loop. If you press that, then this will just play this highlighted selection over and over again. Let me turn that up a little bit. Okay, so those are the pingy sounds. And that was track one of the recording. And then it went into the other pingy things. If I click here, let's go to the selector tool, select here. If I hit play now, you get to that part. And then later on, there's another thing here, and more stuff there, and so on. So the whole audio track is here. All of the sounds are in it. So I'm going to close it here. So that is an example of using Audacity. And it's nice. It's portable. You can take the studio. That's why I call this thing Studio. You can take this with you. And in any computer, you can copy your files into NOAA's stuff, save the projects there, take this to school, plug it into a school computer, run Audacity, and play back all the sounds there. So that's it. In a nutshell, that's it. Now, in the original Patriot drive, there are a lot of tutorials about it. Video tutorials for Audacity. So rather than me talking more about it, there's lots and lots and lots of getting started tutorials here that I look through. They all look pretty simple. I didn't read them all, and there may be some redundancy here, but I'm talking so long, you're probably tired of hearing that. So that will get you started using Audacity. And just to give you an example now of the difference, and I'll finish up here. This will be the last thing I say. I'll load in Cakewalk. And this is the project editor that I use. It used to be called Sonar. No audio devices. Yeah, because I can't use them when I'm running this camera software. All right, so I can't play for you the audio, but I can show you the project. So when Cakewalk comes up, this is free. It's listed on Silent Buses. Yeah, that's because the audio isn't set up. Okay, it starts up by looking at all my instruments, of which there are many, so this will take a while. And then these are my last projects I've worked on. So the Only Way Out project, and so on. I'm just going to close that and open up a blank project. Okay, this is going to run a little sluggishly because the camera software takes up so much computer time. Okay, searching for all my plugins. There's 800 and some plugins. Let's let that finish. And so this is the empty Sonar screen, where the tracks go here and the console's down here. The console is like a mixing area, and the tracks are like what's in Audacity for recording tracks. So what I'm going to do is open up the Only Way Out master. So open that. So I started making this song for you when you asked me for a sonar song. I don't know if you, when you said sonar song, I don't know if you meant the sonar software or a song about sonar. So I used the idea of sonar, the pings, and that led me to think about The Only Way Out. I mean, the Run Silent, Run Deep movie, which I got and recorded the sound and extracted all these sounds from it. And, okay, let's let it run. Now, there's going to be some error messages because the audio is chewed up by this camera software, and it won't let me record audio with this. So it's one of the big drawbacks to this camera software. Otherwise, I'd be making a lot more videos with it. And it's still looking for plugins, so let's let it finish. And then I'll show you more about the project and how they work. And then I'll quit. Actually, I'm about running out of time. I can see this is 26 minutes. So I'm going to stop here and record. Maybe I should just stop. I think I've talked enough. All right, I'll stop here. But you can see the various tracks I used to make The Only Way Out. And these are fader curves in and out, and these are the console panels. If I move this up, each console strip looks just like a typical mixing track. There's the gain at the top, effects sends, the gain levels and stuff like that, just like a channel strip of any mixer. So at the bottom of it are the channel strips. Pull that down, and then at the top are the various tracks, like Audacity shows. So Audacity has this track part to it, and this is the timeline going this way. So the sounds come in, it plays the pings and stuff, and then it goes on and on and on and on. And each of these little pieces were samples that I made or projects I worked on. And it goes on and on and on and on. So those are 16 tracks, and that's it. And I will stop here, pack up all this stuff, and send it to you. Close it. Bye-bye.